staff here? Is this working? Is the microphone? Not really.
No, it was a big candle.
I'll introduce them one by one as we get going and take part. I think that's better than introducing the whole group all at once. Some of you know them all, some of you don't. I'm going to start out as though you knew nothing about what had happened, although a lot of you do know quite a little already. I think I'd like to speak first of Rust, Austria, where the workshop of influential leaders from leaders of political action and leaders of thought met in a workshop November 1st through the 4th. It was symbolic that we met in Rust because that faces a salty lake, and across the lake is Hungary. In other words, you look across the lake through the Iron Curtain to Hungary on the other side. And Austria and Hungary have managed to maintain good relationships in spite of many, many obstacles. So it was a nice symbol of the fact that diverse peoples can live together, meet together, work together. And then the hotel in which we stayed was also important to us. Dr. Karl Vach, who was head of one of the largest banks in Vienna, more than a year ago, offered us the use of this hotel and said that the bank would pay the expenses of the workshop during the 4 days. We all thought at that time there would be about 30 people. As it worked out, there were double that number. Then I want to say something about the sponsorship. The workshop was sponsored by the Center for Studies of the Person, many of whom are here on the stage, and others in the audience. And it was also sponsored by the United Nations University for Peace in Costa Rica. And Rodrigo Carazzo and Murray Silberman of that group were very important in getting together high-level people from Central America and Latin America. Then at our end of the project, Gay Swenson was the co-director of the La Jolla end of the project, and the workshop wouldn't possibly have been put on were it not for her efforts. And all of us worked hard on it, and I'll mention some of that as we go along. I want to say a word about the participants. There were 50 participants, and it was a distinguished group. There were three ex-presidents of Central American countries, the current vice president of Costa Rica. There were three or four from ministries of foreign affairs, including the Ministry of Foreign Affairs for Austria, who visited formally to give the workshop his blessing. Then there were, I think, seven ambassadors, seven or eight legislators. Anyway, it was from various countries, Sweden and Austria and West Germany and I can't name all the Central American countries, Honduras and El Salvador and Nicaragua and Costa Rica, and you help out. Then there were also Venezuela.
Colombia.
Colombia, right.
Mexico.
Mexico, yeah.
Philippines.
And then the other places, the Philippines, Chile.
Hungary,
Poland. That's right.
Germany.
Yeah, I mentioned West Germany, Switzerland. That's right. Anyway, there were 17 countries altogether, and then there was a theme for the workshop: the Central American challenge. That's what accounts for the fact that a lot of the high-status people came from the Central and Latin American countries, and that proved to be a very, very good thing. The question facing all of us was, could a person-centered approach, which had worked before with groups containing hostile factions, could it work with a group at this level, a group where many of them knew nothing about this kind of an approach, knew nothing of the way we worked, and had had very little information before they came as to what they were facing. We had tried to give many of them information, but some of them were last-minute changes, so that a lot of them really came with almost no information about what to expect. And especially, could we handle the kind of feelings that might exist between the United States, people from the United States and from Nicaragua and El Salvador and so on. Then the staff who are here with me on the stage here, and incidentally we don't feel very happy being on stage, but this is the way it was set up. The staff met before and during and after the workshop, and the closeness of the staff was a very important feature of the workshop itself. During the workshop, we met twice a day at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock in the morning, and again after the finish of the small groups. And I'll say more about that in a minute, but that was extremely important. I'll say a word about the format of the workshop. We decided there would be general meetings in the morning and four small groups in the afternoon. And the small groups were carefully selected to be as much a cross-section of the whole workshop as possible, so that people from Central America and the US and so on and the other countries were distributed through each of the groups. Men and women were evenly distributed so far as possible. The small groups were representative. In the general sessions, which met in the morning, we were determined that there would be a minimum of protocol, and I think we pretty well held to that. When it came to introducing the director of the bank that was subsidizing the thing, we had to be a little bit formal. And when the Austrian foreign minister breezed in with the cameras flashing and so on, we had to admit that we had a notable person in our presence. But by and large, we worked on a first-name basis, which was very important. I saw only the general sessions. I was not privileged to be in the small groups, and that's what I want the staff to contribute. But I'll say one or two words about the general session. The first general session started off with a few introductory remarks by me. Then an Austrian diplomat spoke up for a few minutes. Then a young American conservative challenged the Nicaraguan representative, the ambassador, saying, Why is your country shut off human rights? Why have they introduced censorship of the press and so on? And that was quite a tense moment. The Nicaraguan handled it very well. He said, I can't answer that question without giving you a lot of background information. And he gave a lot of well-organized information about his country. Then the discussion was pulled away from that. It's interesting to see the wisdom of the group, because they realized we were not quite ready to handle that kind of confrontation within 3 minutes after the conference started. So it went in other directions for a time. It was followed really by what I would call a lot of presentations. Different members gave good presentations often about their country or about the Contadoras, about different elements of the situation in Central America, but they were presentations. No one listened to one another. It was just a matter of waiting to see when can I get in and give my speech. And I remember feeling very strongly and in a somewhat resigned fashion, I might have to listen to this sort of thing through the whole 4 days. It may be that that's where this group is. But I felt a deep trust in the group process that I've seen so many times, and I felt that, okay, if I have to live with this kind of thing, If this is where they are, if this is where they're going to stay, I'll live with it, I'll accept it. And they didn't stay at that level. I think that it was the patient trust in the group process which really got the workshop off to its start. Just one other thing. Some people, especially Americans who knew something about our work, were complaining by the second day, but we aren't seeing a demonstration of the person-centered procedures. We aren't seeing, Carl isn't demonstrating a person-centered technique and so on. No, and they didn't see much of that through the whole workshop, because somehow the groups almost facilitated themselves. What they did see was a person-centered way, they didn't necessarily see it. What they might have experienced, and which some of them did experience, was a person-centered way of being, and that seemed to make a pretty profound difference. Anyway, I've talked long enough, and I want to have some of the staff members take part next. The Gay Swenson and Norm Chambers were co-leaders of the first group. Norm isn't here.
He's not here yet.
Okay. So. But would you like to tell something of what went on in your small group or anything you want to say?
Yeah, good. I don't particularly want to talk about the small group, but I will cite a few incidents from it. But mostly I'd like to talk, I'd like you to know I'm going to speak on the 6th at the Center for Studies of the Person at 5:30 at length about this. And as I look at my 17 pages of cards here, I think I'll save it until then. But I do want to say a few things about some of the innovations that I think took place there and some of the accomplishments and then some of the challenges that we met and mistakes we made and things like that. And maybe in dialogue later we'll do more of that. But one of the major innovations, I think, was the mixing of metaphors. I mean, we mixed populations and purposes and philosophies and perspectives that I think hadn't been mixed before. We had people from the East Coast and West Coast, and that doesn't sound like much of a mix, but it is. They're a whole different reality of how people work, say, in Washington and how we work in a group, in an encounter group. So that was a mix. It was interesting. We mixed political figures with lay figures and lay people and the psychology mode. So we were dealing across a couple of other ways of seeing reality. We mixed three different sites coming together. Costa Rica at one planning site and Vienna another planning site and here, and trying to resolve the problems that ensued with that mixture was another challenge. We mixed pragmatists and scientists with liberal California transformationalists, and put those two together, and we mixed men and women, and that wasn't easy sometimes. And we mixed, it was just this whole bag full of mixed metaphors as I think about it, and what the accomplishment was I think creating the occasion and a gathering and an opportunity where we kind of got out of the way so that those mixtures could come together and bubble up and interface and get in trouble with each other and try to listen to each other and do their own orating and do their own way of viewing the world. So I think that was really an important innovation. And I think our getting out of the way a lot of the time was central to the staff. I think one of the challenges that we met regularly in this program was to try to balance the personal and the political, because the purposes of there were dual purposes, that's another mix. The purpose of coming together as people in an informal, casual, personal, unstructured, unofficial way, and another population that came there came with a very specific political purpose, the Central American dilemma and the Contadora process, and moving forward with some specific outcomes that they wanted from that. So it was a task for us all to pay attention to hearing under the political statements, hearing the really personal concerns under there, the deep personal concerns that were lived out daily in Central America, and not deny one at the expense of the other. So in part, that's what Carl was describing, that we had some orating and lecturing, but for me, that we were not listening to each other at that time. We weren't listening to each other in a deep, empathic, you know, personal way. We were listening in a way to learn from each other data we really needed to hear. And so one of the accomplishments, I think, or contributions we made was to provide a context where people could be heard, where they could lecture and give information about what it was like to live firsthand in that situation, and in a way be heard when they felt unheard for maybe a century. I'm exaggerating, but one of the themes that came out was how often the Central Americans felt unheard by us in particular. And so somebody may have looked at that and said, well, you just got a lot of lecturing and wasted time. And others may look at it and say you had an opportunity for a catharsis for people to really take their own power in relationship to the United States in particular, I think. I think another challenge we had there was avoiding the us, the them phenomena, and think, and that cropped up a lot. And I think that we have to admit that there were all kinds of us, thems there, especially across these different populations I just talked about. There was some in the staffs. There were three different staffs, you know, so it was hard not to say, what were they doing wrong? What did you do wrong? What did we do wrong? And try to work it out together and keep from thinking of each other in Machiavellian terms, you know, that if somebody was doing something, they were doing it, you know, at the expense of the other group, whatever that other group was. And I think that was a miniature challenge of what we did within the world. So I think we met that a lot. One example is there were some subgroupings that occurred. People sat at tables together at lunch with the Latin group and the staff groups and the this group and the East Coast group and the political groups and the psych groups and stuff. And I think that was the learning that we got out of this, is to plan for that differently so that we really mixed and engaged with each other more. I think the other thing that we learned out of this, or got presented again, was the challenge of the high, to have a high tolerance for ambiguity, because there was so much going on at once in this place that you could get into thinking that there were all these little enclaves and lobbyings and groups outside and around planning things and what was going to come of it, and you never knew. And I just came around to thinking that, well, that's different ways of operating. Some people go out in the hall and operate and lobby together, and other people do it late at night over drinks, and other people do it in a community meeting, and other, you know, it's just different styles of working, and not to think of that as, you know, in this Machiavellian term, as I mentioned. Also, decisions got made so fast over there and changed. I mean, a decision would get made and 5 minutes later it was changed, and that required a tolerance, a high level of flexibility, and it was a test for us. Another issue, and I won't go on much more on this, but another issue I think we confronted was one of authority and hierarchy, that you had populations there of presidents, ex-presidents, you know, ambassadors and so on, and lay people, and I don't like to see different strokes for different folks, and I think one of our goals in that gathering was to relate to each other more equitably and equally, whether you had a power position or not. And I think unconsciously some of that occurred in the name of being polite and honoring, you know, roles. And I think you have to be